Our gospel lesson today is from the book of Mark, chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The word of God to the people of God.
So I want you to do me a favor for a moment. Take out your right hand, or your left, it doesn't matter. Just place it against your heart. And be still for a moment. Take a deep breath in. And just feel for the moment the beating of your heart in your chest. The heart is an amazing muscle. It will beat approximately 3.6 million times this year. That's 2.5 billion times over an average lifespan. Your heart weighs approximately 10 ounces and yet has the power to pump 2,000 gallons of blood through 60,000 miles of blood vessels each and every day. Your heart creates enough energy each day to power a truck for 20 miles. And over the span of an average lifetime, that's enough energy to drive to the moon and back. Now think about this. If you take two heart muscle cells, and you put them side by side in a petri dish, they will beat independently. But as soon as they touch, they begin to beat together. Researchers have also shown that if you see two people who really love one another on a couch a few feet apart, after a few moments, their hearts will begin to beat as one. That's kind of cool. And if you think about it, you are in such a good place today because with this trivia knowledge at your fingertips, when you get to your family dinner, you will wow and impress them. But I just laid that foundation so I can ask you a question. I told you I get thirsty when I preach. So, is this glass half full or half empty? Think about it. Sometimes the answer depends on the day and your mood. But how you answer this question may help determine whether or not you are at risk for heart disease. Just as negative emotions and feelings are risk factors for heart attacks and strokes, happiness seems to produce an effect that protects the heart. At least that was the finding from a large research study done in 2010 that examined the positive impacts of personality traits like happiness and contentment and enthusiasm on heart disease risk. researchers followed 1,739 healthy adults from Nova Scotia, Canada, for a period of 10 years to determine whether or not their attitudes affected their health. And so at the start of the study, trained professionals assessed the participants' degree of expression of negative emotions, like depression or hostility or anxiety. And then they also examined their level of positive emotions, such as joy and happiness and excitement. Now, of course, we all know that even happy people feel negative emotions from time to time, but researchers have discovered those are usually temporary and transient. So after accounting for all known heart risk factors in these 1,700 participants, the researchers found that the happiest people were 22% less likely to develop heart disease than those people who were in the mid-range between happiness and between positive and negative emotions. And then they discovered people with the most negative emotions had the highest risk of heart attack and heart disease. So I guess Bobby McFerrin was right. Don't worry. Be happy. If you don't know what I'm talking about, you're definitely younger than me. Finding my references seem to date me more and more each year. Now the big question I know you're wondering is, okay, you've given me great trivia, you told me how to stop having heart disease, but what does anything that you're saying so far have to do with Easter? Well, I'm glad you asked. Easter is the good news that God has given you and I new hearts. Easter is the good news that God has given God's own heart in Jesus Christ. Instead of a heart that is diseased with sin and shame and guilt and fear, we've been given a heart that beats with forgiveness. It beats with love. It beats with life that not even death can have hope in which we live. This is the hope that we celebrate at Easter. And I am sure, I am convinced that God can sense today within this congregation and within the congregations that are gathering all across this country and all around the world to celebrate Easter. I imagine God can sense the very heartbeat of His Son beating in this room. And that God is weeping tears of pure joy. Because Easter has a lot to do with God's heart. God's heart and love for humanity. But Easter is also about our heart. God has given us this remarkable gift of His heart and calls us to live out of a deep gratitude for the gift we've been given. And when Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome went to the tomb on that first Easter morning, they weren't expecting to be uplifted. They were bringing spices to anoint the stone-cold, very dead body of Jesus Christ. That was a dismal and depressing task that they had to do, but one that they came to do out of love. But as they were walking in that early morning light, they were worried and concerned. How in the world would us three be able to move that giant stone that's in front of the tomb? I mean, look at the front of your cover. That's how big the stone was. How were they going to move it? And yet when they got to the tomb, much to their surprise and much to their joy, much to their shock, they saw that the stone had already been rolled away. And when they entered the tomb, they saw a young man who was not Jesus, dressed in white, sitting on the right side, and I'm sure they thought to themselves, who is this guy? Is it one of the guards? Is it the gardener? Is it a grave robber? And just as they were beginning to wonder who was this man, he began to speak. And he said, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here." You know, there's good news that we share every day, but then there's capital letter good news that you want to shout out loud. This is the capital letter good news. He is risen. But the man in white wasn't finished speaking quite yet. He goes on to say, "Tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." More good news. Jesus is going on ahead of them. Jesus is going to meet them somewhere, sometime in the future. The good news is that Jesus is alive and is waiting for us in the future. When Jesus is raised, he actually succeeds of putting death to death. He smashes the status quo. He turns the table on violence and corruption, on disease and destruction. At the core of the Christian message, at the very heart of the Christian message, is the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is to say, our faith is all about the gospel. And gospel means good news. So I don't know if you can remember this far back, but on December 27th, 2015, as a congregation, we began reading through the Gospel of Mark. And Mark chapter 1, verse 1 begins this way: "The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God." And today we complete the book of Mark, but I think we can complete it in the same way that Mark began it, by saying this is just the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ. But when I think about all of this good news that we celebrate on Easter, I wonder to myself, why are there so many bad news Christians wearing the clothes of a good news Christ? I mean, Easter's not only a time for us to celebrate the resurrection, it's a time where we're called by God to be the good news of Jesus Christ. It's a time for us to take a good look at ourselves and ask, how can I, who have received mercy, not give mercy in return? How can we accept forgiveness but not forgive others? How can we be loved but not love others? How can we be reconciled but not reconciled with others, but not accept others? Because we believe that our hearts beat with the heartbeat of Jesus in us, with the love of Jesus in us, then we should be a community of people who truly love one another so much that our hearts beat as one. And with one heart, God has called us to go out and be the good news in this world and share God's love in simple and in profound ways. Every day, we are called to remind ourselves that Jesus is alive. And that, yes, Jesus is leading us into a better future. It was true when the women visited the tomb. It is true today. And so whether we're facing a time of grief, or maybe a period of personal pain, or maybe an experience of hopelessness and desperation, we can look to a Lord who is alive and well and inviting us to follow him. We can also remind people that the Christ who was crucified knows our deepest personal anguish. The Christ who was lifeless knows the complete desolation of death. The Christ who was raised knows the life-giving power of God. And the Christ who goes ahead of us knows that the future is full of promise and possibility. Let us pray.